And we saw in the lecture how the typical interstellar medium conditions in the Milky Way, for example, affect the gravitational instability. So we saw that when we were looking at the genes mass of a cloud, how a given temperature and a given mass basically set the minimum mass a cloud needs to have, or a subvolume in the cloud needs to have in order to gravitationally collapse. So this also, of course, affects the minimum mass of stars, the maximum mass of stars that are able to form. And since the instability is a strong function also of the temperature, because the lower the temperature a cloud has, the less internal pressure it produces, and the less obstacle gravity has for a collapse. Vice versa, if the temperature in the gas is very, very high, it takes much more mass to become unstable. And the main means of interstellar medium to cool down is by radiation. And one of the most efficient ways is molecular line emission. And in present day molecular clouds, we have, for example, CO, water lines, we have methanol, we have molecular hydrogen. All these molecules are able to radiate energy very efficiently away due to their Einstein-A coefficients, due to their abundances, due to their stability against UV radiation, and so on. So these molecules very strongly contribute to the total energy balance of a molecular cloud, and therefore also then to the stability. And how is this different from the early universe? So if you maybe recall from what you might have learned in the astronomy lectures, is that after the Big Bang and the inflation period and the expansion of the universe, we had matter-dominated periods. And then with the increasing expansion, the density, the overall matter density went down, and at some point it was low enough for the electrons and the protons to recombine again. So that's the recombination period. And this then started the time, or the period basically, at which radiation and matter decoupled. So suddenly the universe became transparent to radiation, because the Thomson cross-section for radiation with electrons and with charged particles is much, much higher compared to neutrals. So what you have basically at the redshift in the order of, so this happened at the redshift in the order of 1,000 or so, was a universe that was had a pretty high mean density, like matter density in the order of a few thousand particles per cubic centimeter, because just the expansion was not as evolved like it is today. And we had temperatures in the order of a few thousand Kelvin. So average temperature, the overall energy density and matter density was pretty high. And what we also had is basically hydrogen atoms. We had a certain population of electrons and a little helium that had been produced in during the Big Bang nucleosynthesis, and like trace elements of lithium. So that's all there was. So first of all, there were no other elements because they were only later produced in stars. So before the first stars had been formed, there was no carbon, there was no oxygen. So we cannot form CO, for example. We cannot form water. We cannot form any molecules other than the most basic molecules that consist of either hydrogen atoms, some isotopes like deuterium, helium, and maybe some more exotic variants of that. For example, we had negatively charged hydrogen that could form H2- or so. So the number of possible molecules is extremely limited compared to what we are able to form today. And what we also not have, so not at all, is any solid body. So there was no dust in the universe. Because this, of course, consists of silicates and carbon and magnesium and all the heavy elements that are only formed like millions and millions of years later during the first generation of stars. So this is the environment that we have. And from this environment, we need to form stars. And to form stars, we need to be able to gravitationally collapse the cloud. But we saw that when we are now in a hot environment, which means we need huge masses to form stars. So I hear later, maybe we do this first. I here compare the Jeans mass. So this can be written down as a function of temperature and gas density like this. And so when we compare the smallest possible mass that is capable of a collapse, for example, today at temperatures of 50 Kelvin and densities of like 1000, and compare this to conditions at a redshift of 1000, so the decoupling, where we had a few thousand Kelvin and a few thousand particle densities, then we have today Jeans masses in the order of a few hundred solar masses. Here's my mouse here. And back then, we have Jeans masses in the order of 100,000 solar masses. And we have the problem now that we have huge volumes of gas that we need somehow to be able to cool down in order to form the first stars. And for this, we need molecules, because electrons are very bad at getting gas down to temperatures below thousands of Kelvin, because in atoms, particularly in hydrogen, the only energy level, the only internal energy that we have is the atomic levels, and we can do ionization and recombination. And we are talking here about energies of in the electron volt range, which corresponds to 10,000 or 100,000 of Kelvin. So we need molecules to be able to access like vibrational and rotational energy levels, internal energy levels. And the only possible molecule is molecular hydrogen. This is not entirely true. There is the possibility to form hydrogen helium, like replace one of the hydrogens in the molecule with a helium, with a helium minus. And this can form a molecule because, of course, helium has a closed shell and cannot undergo binding, but helium minus can do this. That, by the way, is a molecule that has only recently been observed for the first time. So this has been, this was done in our collaboration in Cologne and Bonn. Of course, not one of the primordial ones, but in a like present universe. But that's been observed for the first time. So this is another option, but the more abundant one is, of course, molecular hydrogen. Now, to form molecular hydrogen in the gas without any dust, we have to go by a more complicated route, because we cannot just collide two hydrogen atoms with each other, because due to spin arguments, it is very difficult for two hydrogen atoms to just collide and form a molecule, because for the molecule you need to have a certain spin configuration, and this is basically a forbidden transition in the molecule, and this is super inefficient. That's why under present-day interstellar medium conditions, hydrogen is formed on the surface of a dust grain, where the chemistry has access to the quantum number pool of the solid body, so to speak, and can easily exchange spin configurations. But, so we are now in the early universe, and one way is to form helium by colliding with a negative H minus. This forms an H minus, and then can get rid of the electron basically, and the leftover particle is a molecule. So this is a possible formation route for the molecule, and these chemical reactions are usually described with a reaction rate. So we have some rate coefficient multiplied with the density of each of the two reactants. So and K basically describes the probability for this reaction if two of these particles collide. And this is here described with 1.3 times 10 to the minus 9. So that's a constant number. These are all approximations, of course, but this is about in that order of magnitude. Okay, now to combine, we may have a good idea on the density of NH, because everything is NH, so more or less. But we need to figure out the density of NH minus to compute the formation rate of molecular hydrogen in the gas phase. And to do this, you need to figure out what is the probability for H minus to be formed, and what is the probability for it to be destroyed. And then, if the system has sufficient time, a balance is established. And from this, we can then compute the abundance of H minus. So in this table here, on this overview, I list all the reactions that contribute to the formation or the destruction of H minus if you only have hydrogen and like all the ions available. So first of all, we can form it when hydrogen and an electron collides. This forms an H minus, and these radiative association reactions, that's how they are called. They are called radiative association because the association, so the coming together of the two particles, creates a photon. That carries away the surplus kinetic energy and also the surplus angular momentum. The reaction rate coefficient of this reaction is a function of the temperature. It can be written like this. Again, this is a fit, an approximation to these, to the true reaction rate that, if we are lucky, are measured in the lab. And if we are unlucky, they are only computed. So this is a formation reaction for H minus. And similar to this, the reaction is K1 times the density of H times the density of the electrons. When we have the possibility that the H minus collides with a hydrogen atom like here and then forms the molecule, this will destroy the H minus, and we saw that this is the rate. We also have the possibility that H minus is basically hit by a photon. So this is the back reaction here of this, that again splits an electron here apart. So that is the radiative dissociation reaction. That's a function of the intensity of the photon density and the attenuation of the cloud. Alternatively, you can write, so now one question is, where do these photons come from? When we are looking at the molecular cloud nowadays, that's easy because all the photons are produced by stars. So this is ultraviolet radiation that is produced by stars and then can interact with the atoms and the molecules. But we are now in a period of time where there are no stars. There are no stars, so there is no easy way to produce ultraviolet photons. And that's also the reason why this is called the dark ages, so to speak, because we have no easy way to create radiation. That's why you can formulate this also in terms of the radiation temperature of the universe, because of course we have radiation, and this radiation is basically the leftover from the Big Bang. Nowadays, this radiation has a temperature of 2.7 Kelvin, so it's very much in the microwave region, but at a C of 1000, this was in the range of thousands of Kelvin, so this is basically optical radiation. So it's a black body that was much hotter, and also had some ultraviolet component to some degree. And of course, when we have this here, we also create photons. And this photon can then at some point hit an H minus. So there are photons, we just have to describe this a little bit different. So you can describe this also here with this formula. And Then there's the possibility that we have an H plus and an H minus interact, like collide, recombine basically, or exchange the charge, and we are left with two neutral hydrogens. Then there is the question where this H plus comes from, because to ionize hydrogen we need photons with 13.6 electron volts, which corresponds to, well, one electron volt is in the order of 12,000 Kelvin, so we are at 150,000 Kelvin temperature. So this is maybe not so important, but these are the reactions that can take place when you only have hydrogen available. Okay, now to actually compute this, we can show that the density of the H minus can be written like this, and that's pretty simple, because what you do is you write down a balance between formation and destruction. So formation was this one, K1 times the electron density times the hydrogen density, and the formation and the destruction were all the others. So all the others means NH minus times, and then K2 times the hydrogen density plus K3 plus K4 times the density of H plus. So that you immediately see when we divide by this term here in parentheses, we find the expression for the H minus density under equilibrium when we know the density of all the others. Of course, you can also write this down as a set of four coupled differential in terms of differential equations, and write this then as a time dependent thing, because we are now in equilibrium, but of course these different numbers here mean that the reactions have different speeds, so to speak, so they are differently fast. Okay, good. Anyways, we can first just plot this for different densities as a function of the attenuation. So that means how deep into a molecular cloud we go. And you see that this is now, when we assume that the electron and the H plus density is the same and corresponds to like 10 to the minus 4 of the total hydrogen density, and we have a temperature of 1000 Kelvin, then these are densities of NH minus that establish under the balance condition. So we have here, like, depending on the density, an order of magnitude. So this goes, scales directly with the density NH. Because these cancel with these work with NH and cancel out, but this scales also with NH. Okay. But there's also an alternative way to look at this, and I just prepared this like 10 minutes ago. So this is basically we do this here on the go. We can also express the temperature as a function of the redshift. And the same is possible with the density. So it turns out that when we look at the temperature of the cosmic microwave background, this can be written as present day temperature times 1 plus the redshift C. And we can also express the density, matter density, as a function of the redshift and some cosmological parameters like the Hubble constant and the cosmological density parameter here. And I put some like standard values that are outdated. So nowadays the Hubble constant is more in the order of 65 or 70, maybe even higher. I just put in these numbers. Well, now I put in 70 here because this I know. And then it scales with 1 plus the redshift to the power of 3. Which means I can take this formula and everywhere where I have the temperature, I just assume that we have still a tight coupling between the radiation temperature and the gas density. So this is an equilibrium. And I replace this temperature here with just this temperature. And I replace the hydrogen density with this density. And then we are left with a function that is only a function of the redshift, and we need to somehow express the amount of electrons and H plus. Because I replaced them with this ionization fraction times the density. Okay, so we can write down this equation. And I haven't plotted this yet, so let's see what we find here. So my system here is a little bit unstable. Can I get some feedback whether you have flickering or somehow strange videos, video connection from my side, or is this okay? Anything? The video freezes sometimes. Okay. It also freezes on my side, so something is happening. I hope we won't have a crash like we did last week. Okay. Let's see. How do we do this here? Okay, let's say this is 10 to the minus 4. Okay, let's do two different things. So let's keep this constant for the moment, and then we do it from a C of 1 to 1000. Log. Okay, so on the x-axis we have the redshift, and on the y-axis we have now the H minus abundance. So here we were in the range of like 10 to the minus 11 to 10 to the minus 7. And here we have this. Okay. So this neglects any form of absorption from every 2 minutes. This is neglecting every absorption by AV, which makes sense because we have no dust to produce attenuation. Yeah. So, but as a function of redshift, when we say this is the ionization fraction, then this looks like this. But of course, maybe I have this here somewhere. Because the ionization fraction is also a function of redshift usually, and I didn't have time to look up the a good description of this or compute this. So what we do is just we make a very simple assumption that is basically similar to this. We make it a function of the redshift. This is probably superly wrong, but just to see, So when we go back in time, we have a higher degree of electrons and H plus. Necessarily also H plus, because the electrons need to be coming from an from some ionization process, of course. So let's see. So we should get two curves here. And we are now in the range in the order of 10 to the minus 8. So a relatively significant amount. Okay. So I need to look this up here. Okay. We can now look at how is this efficiency to form H2 different from nowadays conditions. And here in this section, I ignore like the two reactions with the radiation, and we just compare the formation and here the destruction reaction. And what is this? Okay, so that's a somewhat simpler formation rate expression, and when we plot this, it looks like this. For an ionization fraction of 10 to the minus 4. So that's the rate at which H minus, at which molecular hydrogen is formed. And we can compare this with the rate at which molecular hydrogen is formed nowadays. And this takes place on the surface of dust grains. So you have individual hydrogen atoms colliding with a dust grain. And on the surface of the grain, they basically randomly walk around. And when they hit another hydrogen, they can form a molecule. And when they form the molecule, the binding energy is released. And this is 4.5, 4.48 to be precise, electron volts. So that's a lot of energy. And some of this energy is used to detach the molecule from the dust grain surface. Part of the energy goes then into kinetic energy, so it flies away with a certain velocity. And some of the energy goes into internal energy. And this is described here with this expression. This is the rate at dust grain surfaces. So that's 3 times 10 to the minus 18 times the density of hydrogen atoms times the total density, because the total density tells us something about the density of dust grains. And then we have here a couple of factors. So this comes from the thermal velocity of the particles when they hit the grain. When they hit the grain, we have a certain accommodation coefficient Fa here. So that describes the time this particle has before it bounces back. And we have a probability for the particle to stick. This is the so-called sticking coefficient, so that it actually sticks on the grain. So these are all functions of the dust and the gas temperature. And we can just assume certain numbers here and compute the densities. So let's see. Here I define the function. And then I try to figure out at what temperature the two are the same. Here I plot them. And the red one is the gas reaction rate that we computed earlier. So colliding the H and the H minus. And this is the one on the dust grains, which at higher temperatures goes down because the probability of rebouncing becomes too strong. So it's not sticking on the grain. And you see that for this gas route to be more efficient, we need temperatures more than 1000 Kelvin, 1100 something to be precise. So what this means is that under present day conditions in a molecular cloud, this we can ignore this, so it's unimportant. But if we don't have this here, this is the only means to form H2 and to then basically allow for a collapse. And later in the lecture we will look at what exactly happens when the cloud collapses and tries to radiate the radiation away. Okay, good. Maybe in a later Q&A I will go a little bit into detail how from these formation and destruction reactions we establish basically a chemical structure. Because when you go into a cloud, the temperature slowly goes down, densities might go up. So this is like a relatively complex thing, but we can, for example, look at where we have a transition from atomic to molecular hydrogen and so on. Okay. Yeah, here I just plot the density as a function of redshift, and this, you see that when we are at a redshift of 1000, we have a few thousand densities here. Okay, good. So, if you don't have any questions on that, I have here another section that was also used as a problem like many years back, where we again look at the magnetic support of clouds and the reason why when we did the energy comparison, so how much energy in the interstellar medium goes into like kinetic energy, gravitation, magnetic energy, and we saw that this is to some degree always the same amount of energy. So let's consider some spherical cloud of gas. We have a certain mass and radius, we have a certain velocity dispersion, and the thing is threaded by a magnetic field with the strength B. And we saw that the magnetic flux, if it's sufficient that we have some magnetic flux that, how did we call this? I don't recall, but we saw that the flux density of the magnetic field lines, when they are above a certain critical threshold, can prevent further collapse because they work against further compression of the magnetic field lines. So, and we can now look, we can now show that the cloud's Alphen Mach number MA only depends on the virial ratio and on this ratio between the mass and the magnetic flux mass, so to speak. And we ignore any four factors. So, the virial ratio, again ignoring any prefactors here, is basically the ratio between the kinetic and the potential energy. So the kinetic energy goes with the velocity squares, this is this, and we have here the potential. So this is the virial ratio, and we saw that in the Milky Way this is always in the order of unity, so the two are about balanced, and the clouds are stable. Bound, not, yeah. The Mach number, on the other hand, is the ratio of the velocity dispersion to the Alphen speed, and we can write this down in units of the magnetic field and the density. And if we, from the spherical shape and the total mass, we can write down the square root of the density in terms of the mass and the radius. So that's the Alphanic speed. And with this, we can then divide the velocity dispersion by the Alphanic speed and get here this expression. And when we replace the mass by this this flux, critical flux ratio here times the flux mass, so to speak, we can write this down in terms of the m phi. And when we insert this into the Alphanic Mach number, we get this expression. And we can replace the sigma in units of the virial ratio. So at the end, and then all the g's and m's and r's nicely cancel out. So that means we are left with this expression. So the Alphanic Mach number is proportional to the product of this mu phi and the virial ratio, more to speak. So now the interesting thing is this relation, leaving all four factors aside, means that if two of them, no matter which two, if two of them are in the order of unity, this means that the third one automatically also must be in the order of unity, comparable. So So what we show here is that if any two of these three are of order unity, the third one must be as well. And this, of course, is related to the energy distribution because these are measures of energy ratios. So MA basically measures the ratio of the kinetic energy to the magnetic energy. We saw this here. The virial ratio measures the ratio of the kinetic to the gravitational energy, and the mu phi, well, squared, measures the ratio of the gravitational to magnetic. And accordingly, if two of them are in order of unity, that implies that kinetic, gravitational, and magnetic energies are basically of comparable size. And so automatically sets the third of these ratios here. Yeah. Okay. So, and then when we look at magnetized turbulence, this automatically produces an MA in the order of 1. And this explains why it is difficult to determine by observation whether clouds are supported by turbulence or by a magnetic field. Because when it is supported, this means our alpha, so it's not collapsing, it's not dispersing. That means we have a virial ratio of 1, order 1. And we will have an MA of 1, because that's the result of being turbulent. Which also means that we will measure this flux ratio here of 1, no matter whether we have a magnetically supercritical or subcritical cloud. So that means we only will find something that some mu that is very larger than 1 if we have a cloud that is not virialized, so an alpha that is very different from 1.